Hello and welcome to Westwind, an audio podcast about cancer, technology in medicine, and policy issues. I'm host and medical oncologist, Dr. Jack West, from the City of Hope Comprehensive Cancer Center in the Los Angeles area. You can find Westwind material at beaconmedic.com, at iTunes, or just about anywhere you get podcast content. I would just ask that you show your interest and support by subscribing, commenting, sharing by telling friends and colleagues in person and on social media, and rating it however you feel is appropriate. You can also share your ideas and opinions by emailing us at westwindpodcast@gmail.com. Many of us are isolated and have been working from home for a week or more, so I think it's only fitting that I do this podcast now, just offering some of my own thoughts, specifically on what the coronavirus hath wrought, here focusing on some of the potential silver lining around that dark cloud. Now, COVID-19 problems are in stark relief in the news every day. Along with the terrible toll on the economy and society broadly, we in medicine face a new risk from our patients coming to the clinic or hospital, patients with cancer seemingly having a higher risk of developing the infection and complications, perhaps due to the cancer itself, association with advanced age, comorbidities, and potentially with exposures inherent in just getting treated. Now, hard-hit places don't have access to personal protective equipment. Procedures may be rationed, ICU space and ventilators are often not readily available. This has required physicians to sometimes make painful decisions about prioritizing, triaging who receives ventilator support and who doesn't. COVID-19 has been nothing less than a tragedy for the economy and society broadly, but it has forced the oncology world to take a hard look at our practices and potentially right-size some of our practices. This concept of right-sizing is really a corporate euphemism for reducing the size of a workforce to streamline operations, but the concept of identifying and reducing waste to emerge more efficient is very reasonable. It has taken us no less than a life-threatening pandemic to change the status quo, forcing us to re-examine our standard practices and finally begin to integrate telemedicine and virtual meetings at a level that can better approach their true potential. Confronted by a time when patients merely coming to the clinic is suddenly associated with non-trivial risk, we're now forced to ask ourselves and actually explore with our patient the magnitude of benefit of pursuing immunosuppressive chemotherapy. And as we do that, we clearly recognize that there is plenty of opportunity to be more judicious about visits, scans, anti-cancer treatments, and the use of newly very finite and suddenly scarce medical resources, ranging from personal protective equipment to ICU beds. Specifically, we can reflect that trials that have been designed for continuing ongoing maintenance therapy without an endpoint, or that extend for many years, may well reach a point of diminishing returns after a fixed duration of therapy. It probably bothered us less than it should have that the often industry-designed trials that continued extremely expensive medications ad infinitum were only potentially wasting large sums of societal money or minimized concern about cumulative toxicities. But suddenly, there's a real risk of gratuitous exposures to someone with COVID-19 on what may just be a ritual-based repeat visit. We reflect on the absolute benefit of a marginally useful adjuvant therapy or even what is often just a reflexive move to biopsy and resect a nodule that grew from 5 to 7 millimeters over a couple of years in a 79-year-old. We consider exactly why we have people come in every 6 to 8 weeks for a ritualized visit and labs to confirm that they're still doing just as well as they have for the last 14 months on some targeted therapy. Our plans to have them get scans every 3 months for surveillance is an arbitrary timeline in most cases, and it's probably perfectly fine to space out that interval more. We're tasking ourselves with prioritizing which procedures are compelling and not just reflexive when hospitals are closely guarding their limited supplies of equipment. We're developing policies that challenge the wisdom of having so many bedridden, heavily treated patients admitted to an ICU to die after a prolonged interval on a ventilator when it should have been known to be medically futile from the beginning in many cases. It's horrifying to know that ER docs and pulmonologists are forced to choose which patients requiring intubation get the opportunity for ventilator support or not. The least we can do is to not be disdainful of these needs by sidestepping overdue discussions of realistic goals of care. If there is any upside to our upheaval, it's that it took this kind of societal seizure to break our widespread institutional apraxia about how we do things or what we can't do. We've had the hardware, software, and internet capability to do telemedicine for several years, but it has long been relegated to peripheral use. In the US, at least, I see this as being due to several factors, most notably unreliable reimbursement and restrictive licensure across states. My California license allows me to drive legally in neighboring Nevada or any other US state, but if I want to see a Las Vegas resident on a telemedicine visit, that's not really feasible right now. They need to drive 3.5 hours to my clinic because every state has a separate licensing, for which they charge typically about $400 to $500 per year for the opportunity to treat their state's residents. In fact, the states vary, but are often deliberately onerous in these processes. And I can tell you that Nevada's licensure process is a time-consuming one that takes many months, requires submission of literally a hard copy of my actual birth certificate, and is altogether a remarkably sadistic process, harder than an IRS audit in many ways. Why do we have such an archaic system rather than the reciprocality that would acknowledge that a physician licensed in New York State is qualified to treat patients in Arkansas or Nevada or wherever? And I see there being three main reasons. First, states make money charging extortionate fees for medical licensing, so they have an incentive to add gratuitous processes that line their coffers. Second, state governments are protectionist on behalf of their own state's medical community, making it difficult for out-of-state doctors to provide good and even potentially superior care to their state's residents who may need it. Rather than enable competition, highly restrictive licensing serves the interests of that state's medical community at the expense of its own residents. And third, it's a change, and inertia is a powerful force. There are powerful incumbents who want to protect the status quo. Infusing all of this is institutional apraxia. Hospitals and healthcare systems are big corporate structures with layers of sclerotic bureaucracy. So even when an advance is excruciatingly evident, nothing tends to happen until a global crisis forces that to happen. And suddenly, with telemedicine being the most screamingly obvious advance that is already completely ready to implement, the U.S. federal government and an ever-growing number of state legislatures only now begins to lower barriers to telemedicine in order to deal with the requirement that the entire population minimize actual movement, but also still need medical care. Of course, legal issues are still much of a work in progress, but we've finally broken the impasse of a remarkably good idea that has been completely underused for years because we just haven't bothered to acknowledge what a good idea it truly is. Once the restrictions on payment are lifted because it becomes painfully clear that we cannot perpetuate these restrictions without justification, the floodgates are destined to open. And so with sudden urgency, many cancer centers are belatedly offering telemedicine visits for patients. With this, we're learning a few things. First, there are some patients and settings for which telemedicine is extremely well-suited. Patients who are clinically stable on ongoing treatment, patients who would otherwise be coming in for a periodic review of scans, and many new patients who may be coming for a second opinion to discuss potential management options are often eager to minimize their visits to the clinic and be spared a long drive for an interaction that can be done just as well via telemedicine. And as many of us do the first of these visits, we and our patients begin to wonder why we weren't doing this sooner and far more often. This isn't to say that it's the right tool for every job. Our early forays into telehealth also highlight that some of our patients don't have good internet access or have technological challenges of installing new apps and navigating to the online waiting room. For that matter, quite a few of our healthcare practitioners may struggle initially with the tech requirements as platforms have been rolled out on an urgently expedited timetable. Importantly, for some institutions, these early efforts have just been on Skype or FaceTime or other familiar platforms, which have been granted at least temporary sanction as kosher for healthcare. Others of us have been long awaiting activation of dedicated telehealth platforms. My own institution, City of Hope, has had a partnership for over a year with one of the leaders in the field, American Well. But even with all of the components of a potential reaction already present, the coronavirus outbreak was the catalyst required to finally initiate it. Using telehealth in earnest for the first time is introducing us to challenges like how to integrate interpreters, how to consider appropriate workspaces and backdrops, how to greet and comfort patients without being in the same room together. But we need to remember that we've been doing direct in-person medicine for millennia, but we're essentially babes in the woods in terms of telemedicine. And with experience and training at Webside Manor, we're only going to get better at it, probably quickly. Meanwhile, we've also had to overhaul how we meet for everything from departmental meetings to tumor boards to larger conferences like ASCO. We've had the capacity to turn our routine meetings into Zoom conferences, which would make a lot of sense as many of our institutions now span across many sites and require travel to all sit in the same room. But suddenly, now we're actually doing it, particularly as so many of us are working from home because of choice or strong recommendation or the law. And we found that it often works extremely well. The Earth still turns on its axis, and we've been able to have perfectly productive conferences from our offices or homes as alternates to these live meetings. And we can even potentially do it while wearing sweatpants. This year is going to bring some sea changes for larger conferences as well. Many have been canceled or postponed, and others, like ASCO, will now be done virtually. In many ways, this is a big loss, though it's not remotely feasible to now expect to conduct a live conference that's intended to draw tens of thousands of people from around the world to convene for several days in close proximity to one another. This year would have marked my 20th consecutive ASCO meeting, and I recognize the irreplaceable value of planned and unplanned direct connections with dozens to hundreds of colleagues in that time, sharing the communal experience of learning much and discussing things together. I'm confident we'll find that a well-done virtual ASCO will clearly be different from the live version, but it will also be a valuable and highly gratifying event in its own right. Of course, watching the Super Bowl from home isn't the same thing as being there for the live event, but it's still worth seeing however you can. And like attending the Super Bowl live, ASCO is very expensive. Hotel prices jacked up to twice the normal rate, and there's long lines and hassles that beg the question of whether there's another potentially better way, at least an alternative to consider. And this was the case even before COVID-19. There are many critical open questions, including how long the threat of COVID-19 will persist. I think most sentient people recognize the conjecture that things in the U.S. should open back up and return to normal by Easter is patently ridiculous and irresponsible. But we can't really know whether we will need to remain extremely cautious about venturing out for another few weeks, 3 or 6 months, or whether there will be a chronic lower level but still looming threat long beyond that. We'll be able to battle test these concepts of streamlining our oncology care, eliminating unnecessary interventions and visits, transitioning appropriate patients from live clinic visits to telemedicine ones, and exploring over the long term which of our meetings, from the weekly departmental ones to annual international ones, can be run perfectly well on virtual platforms. It would be wrong to take these lessons born of this crisis and not have them lead to sustained, broadly reaching benefits well into the future. I've obviously covered a lot of ideas here, and I'm very interested in your thoughts, whether you agree or not, what I might have overlooked. Please comment on social media. I'm on Twitter at handle @JackWestMD or via email at westwindpodcast@gmail.com. I think it's a Chinese curse and not a blessing when they say, may you live in exciting times. But either way, there's a lot to talk about here, and I'd love to continue that discussion. Thanks for listening. The West Wind Podcast is a Beacon Medical Interchange production with sound engineering and distribution by Mark Lindsay of Talking Speaker. We hope you'll be motivated to subscribe, whether at beaconmedic.com, through iTunes, or through another podcast service. Please also rate it, and I hope you'll be inclined to tell friends and colleagues in real life and on social media. We're always happy to get your suggestions and other input at westwindpodcast@gmail.com. Talk to you again soon.